Hello. Hello, I'm from Submarine, and welcome to the presentation about building pipelines for the unexpected. Today you'll have me, the head of recruitment at Submarine, and my colleague Thierry Paalman. He is the head of technology there. And I'm just going to tell a little bit about our company first, and then he'll do the interesting stuff. I'm just here to have a little of an extra to tell about the company. So kind of what makes us unique, I think, as a company is that we have a very diverse or like a very varied slate of kind of projects. We are very keen on doing a lot of different techniques, and I just want to show our little show wheel to prove that. So a little showcase of what we do. Thank you very much. To give you a bit of a sense, we've been in, like, the company's been around for over like 20 years and started out with doing more film and documentary. But since like 2007, we started to play with the idea of doing animation. And then it really got real in 2016 when we started with the Welly Wishers. And from there, from doing like that kind of projects, we went all over the place to now where we recently finished the Dream of a Thousand Cats for the Sedman show. And in that whole period, we've done all kinds of techniques, and from 2D film, which is one of our projects, Buñuel in the Labyrinth of Turtles, Twee Kleine Kreutjes is one of our 3D films, also done in Blender, Apollo 10 and a Half, which is like also a rotoscoping film, and then we have Coppelia, which was a hybrid where we combined 2D backgrounds with 3D characters and also had ballet. This is kind of like just to give you a sense of all the different things we do, but also now my colleague will tell you a bit more about how we adapt our pipeline to doing such varied projects. So here's Thierry.
Wow, I can use tech more. Hello, everybody. So thank you, Milo, for the introduction of Submarine. I'm going to specifically talk about three projects today, to keep it a bit short and brief, and also to mostly demonstrate the things that we actually use Blender for. As you can see, we use a lot of different softwares. We're not like a Blender studio, but we're a studio that uses Blender. So I'm going to talk about Undone, Apollo 10 and a Half, and then Twee Kleine Kleutjes. And for Twee Kleine Kleutjes, I'll dive a little bit deeper into the technical things that we do on the pipeline end, and especially what we learned from this project and where we are going to improve. So starting with Undone. Undone was a special project for us. It came in 2018 with the director, Hisko Hulsing. He brought the project into our studio, and it was a series for adults, which is kind of rare in animation, a drama series as well. So it's kind of a series that we'd actually watch ourselves, which is also, I mean, pretty cool to make sometimes. So this is a short clip or trailer for Undone.
I'm so bored of living. I wake up every morning in the same bed, I get dressed, and I eat the same breakfast and then take the same commute to work. I'm 28 years old and I'm terrified. This is all there is. Is this a dream?
Well, partly.
I know 2 weeks is a long time for me to be away.
If you're feeling weird about anything, just come talk to me and we'll figure it out.
You don't need to worry about me because I'm pretty much okay.
Pretty much.
You're fine, right?
I just feel like everyone's messing with me.
You're acting even stranger than usual. You usually act even stranger than usual. But since the accident, you have been acting more even stranger than usual than usual.
I'm seeing my dead father.
I was.
Right, I'm going to stop. You can watch the whole thing on Amazon. There's two seasons now. So we, of course, started with live action. Well, I say of course, but that's not that quite logical for animation. But because this was identified as a rotoscope show, we had the producer also on board of Scanner Darkly, so it made sort of sense to continue on in this technique. But what we did to prepare for the live action shoot was build every set before they start shooting in 3D as a sort of blocking / sort of floor plan for the shoots, so that we know that they don't shoot anywhere where the character accidentally walks through walls and we have to later on fix that in post. Still a lot of fixing in post, but I mean, the idea was there. Like, you can see the lines here on the floor, those are tape marks, and the color basically identifies which set is being used. So I'll walk you through how we created this shot specifically. One of the things that the director wanted to do, which is also kind of rare, is have every painting or every background as an oil painting. So a traditional, like this canvas big oil painting. So we've made about 2,000 of those. So I'll show you how those are made and how we kept those in sort of a pipeline, like a modern pipeline, where we can actually control things. So it's a very basic shot on purpose, not to spoil anything of the series. So this was the blocking for the set. So all done in Blender. You can see all the cameras there in the scene file. Basically we get a good idea of what we're actually dealing with before we start shooting. And then can act like direct the actors to act accordingly. But that is pretty useful, because then when they came back with that live action footage that you just saw, we can overlay that again with the camera that we've created in 3D to get a layout for the background painting, and that you'll see in the next slide. So it's a line render, some freestyle and some custom plugins. That's basically a guideline for the painters on what to paint to make sure that like the plant on one shot is actually also in the next shot. Of course, we have a little bit less control with that, with such a like manual process as oil painting, like no layers, no control C, no, yes. And then, so this is projected onto the canvas, like with a beamer, and then traced the lines on there, and they fill it in, paint by numbers. Well, it's more complicated than that. I shouldn't say that. this is the result, the final result. And then this is what it looks like with all of the layers there and composited. Again, not a very special shot, but it doesn't distract from the background too much. After that, and while we're doing season two, we also did Apollo 10 and a Half, which is a film by Richard Linklater. Again, with the producer also attached from Scanner Darkly, rotoscope film this time. We did have a little bit less preparation time than we did with Undone, so we had, I think, 2 weeks before we started shooting to make all of the sets. And for this one, we also brought something special on board, but I'll first show you a little clip of this.
Where's that kid?
Mission? For what?
We accidentally built the lunar module. A little too small.
How'd that happen?
Listen, are you good at math?
Yeah.
Do you get a perfect 100 on every test?
No.
Okay. We need a kid like you to test this accidentally smaller version on the lunar surface and soon.
Stan, you're our only hope.
Okay.
Great. Let's forget about all this for now. We'll come back to this part later.
First, let me tell you about life back then.
Living in the Houston area in the late 60s, it was a great time and place to be a kid. But the world was changing, and so was how we saw ourselves in it.
Right on.
Mom, is that one a hippie?
Yeah, that's a hippie.
How about that one?
No, his hair's not long enough.
But he's wearing bell bottoms.
Okay, that's a hippie.
I think I like hippies.
All right. Sorry, guys. We're a bit short on time. So we brought an NCAM to the set along with us, or we hired an NCAM operator and a kit. And that's basically a camera that can track 3D in real time. So we could do a little bit of virtual production light, so we can see where we're actually in camera on the set with our 3D sets, and the director could tell us, no, the set should be a little bit to the left or to the right. It looks very raw, but I mean, it did give a sense of like our actual assets that were in frame. So here you'll see that.
We now know JFK didn't die that day in Dallas. Poor man was rendered a vegetable due to the severe brain trauma from the bullets. But they are keeping him alive in seclusion on a Greek island. They didn't think the country could handle seeing their president as a vegetable, so they are shielding us from the true facts. It's Aristotle Onassis's island, which explains his marriage to Jackie.
And then I have brought along a little breakdown of the whole clip. So for some things, we went a little bit more 2.5D approach. Was just easier working that way. But then for other things, we also we projected onto the 3D model again, which you can see in the next breakdown. So yeah, this was what it looks like. So the model was created in Blender, and then it was like projected in Nuke, and the reflections that you also saw in the breakdown. We also had cars in there. So we said, well, those you also want to make in 3D. It's a bit difficult to like manually draw a car every frame to be consistent. So
the closest we ever got to the action was when we were in Houston with Mom.
Very short clip. These are all rendered in Blender using like this kind of setup. And then above is what it looks like when it's all composited together. Okay. And then there was 2KK. Twee kleine kleutertjes. I'm not going to say that aloud quite a lot because it's so long. So I'm going to say 2KK. And this was a pretty standard Blender pipeline. It was our first full feature in Blender. But I mean, we didn't do like very extraordinary things. We rigged the characters as you would rig them in Blender, and we'd done the shaders as you would do the shaders in Blender. Here's a small little clip, but I will explain more about the pipeline for this project and all of our other projects after. There you go.
Mama, ik wil de baby horen. Hoe gaat hij heten? Niet Joey, hè? Zo heet ik al.
Nee, joh. Want het wordt een zusje.
Wat het wordt is nog een verrassing.
Oh.
Vandaag gaan jullie een dagje op pad met oom Bob.
Ja!
Hey, psst. Jij heet toch Joey?
Ja!
Ik ben Han.
Kan je echt praten?
Ja, ja.
All right. So that's more for the Dutch audience, completely different audience as well. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our pipeline. First, I need to introduce our pipeline, and then I can talk about what we learned about what we can do better, which I think is the more interesting part. So our pipeline, like you can see, we do a lot of different things. We have a lot of different departments, and it's not all like really tangible in the beginning what it will be. So we set it up to basically be able to do everything. So we support a lot of DCCs, a lot of different outputs, but we do keep them sort of together, as I'll explain later. So when I talk about this part of the pipeline, I specifically mean like what happens from one task to the other task. So when one artist gives their work over to the second artist. So things like naming convention, the export settings of the thing, where it is on the server, how you version up, those kind of things. And that's quite important because for Undone we had 25,000 tasks for one season, and for Apollo, for example, 10,000. So I mean, those handing over of files happens quite a lot. That's not even like the specific versions. Those must even be 10 times larger. So this is what it looks like. So we have Turbine, which is our core. It's based on Avalon a couple of years back, and maybe some of you are familiar with that. OpenPipe also is based on Avalon. We still kept it relatively the same, but made it our own, like, how it works in the back end. So that takes care of like where things are on the server, what the naming convention is, those kind of things, and how to communicate with the DCCs. And then we have Sonar. Sonar is our configuration on top of that. For the configuration, that's how do you actually use the software. So that's where all of the plugins are for if you want to export a model, then the code in Sonar will tell you what that model should be like. And then we have a project-specific add-on for each project in which the TD can basically dump their code that they want in the production without having too many code reviews and without bothering all the other projects. So Turbine and Sonar are shared among all projects. Of course, you subscribe to a major version and you don't like version up during the production, and that's like when something really big happens, but they can iterate on Sonar and on the add-ons quite a lot during production. Then we sync the entire database to ShotGrid or from ShotGrid or Kitsu. So that is leading in that sense. You start making assets in ShotGrid, and those get then dumped in the database. We found that it's just easier for production to use. We don't have to help them all that much. And then Torpedo, which is our launcher for REST. So we use REST for pretty much everything. So even Blender itself is a REST package. REST is a package manager that you can say, all of my packages are here on the server, and if you resolve it, you need to draw from this folder instead of from PyPy or wherever else you would get your packages from. So we can control our environments pretty well with this. Right, then this is what it looks like in Blender. So you would publish your versions from Blender. Those get dumped to the database. You can retrieve them with a loader. And if you load them in, you'll see in your inventory all of the versions that you've loaded in and the current status of that version. So if it's the latest or not. And this is pretty still vanilla Avalon, how it looks like at least. We haven't touched it that much. But you can then also manage your assets in here, so you can say, I want this to be another version, I want this to version up, I want everything to version up. And then when you publish, it'll tell you, oh, are you sure you want to publish? You have some versions that are not like the latest, those kind of things. It does some other checks as well. Okay. So how we achieved this was basically with a modularity is king approach. So everything we do needs to be modular because we don't know how we're going to use it in the future, and we don't know how, what it will be for other projects as well. So everything that you can see here, so pipeline, every setting that would be useful for other projects needs to be exposed. So for example, the scale of an alembic or the frame rate of an image sequence, all those kind of things, like it needs to be in the pipeline. It never needs to be different from one asset to the other. So that's the second one. Assets should, of the same type, should have the same parameters. So whenever you publish a model, it's always in the same scale. It's always the same naming convention. Whether it comes from Blender or from Maya, it's always the same. The same with environments, and that's like the whole REST thing that we use, is that on Artist 1's PC, it needs to be exactly the same as on Artist 2's PC, and also when they submit to the render farm, that whole environment gets resolved so that it's exactly the same. No different version of like FFmpeg or some other like things that we can't control. Then there's for the development, also developing like with future implementations in mind, so keeping a very open idea of what this current plugin is and what it will be in the future. And then for releases, as I just explained, we have a sort of three-step process which we can add on to our existing code. Now for 2KK, the pipeline was pretty simple, so this is even an abbreviated one. I couldn't find it, so I had to recreate it. But like it, you can see it's pretty linear task workflow. And it just goes from one step into the next one. And that's exactly what we want to change, because with the other projects, we had this in Nuke. So this is a build file, which means that everything that comes before it is collected into this one Nuke compositing file, because for compositing, we always knew that that would be the last step of our production. So that made more sense. So this happens when the artist of the, or the compositing artist presses on the button build, and it collects the background because that's linked in ShotGrid. It collects all of the render passes that come out of animation, and basically tries to assemble the whole thing together as best as it can. So here you can see like this is what it sort of looks like for a background. So there's some notes in there already for cropping and some notes for noise, for characters. It's all this neat setup already which characters or which layers are on top of which other layers and how those maybe need a small blur or a noise. So we thought we could do the same thing for our 3D files, and then it would look something like this. So we start working with assembly files, and assembly files, once we have a downstream and upstream like awareness in the pipeline, we can sort of say to every task, like, you're an assembly task and you need to collect everything that comes before you into this one file, as you can see here. Let me see, it actually makes more sense maybe with the next one. So that means for version loading, we can do this. We can say what we currently have is a pinned workflow. So every artist picks the version that they want to use in their scene. But we also can introduce subscription workflow, or subscription version loading, which means you just keep updating your version until it hits approved in ShotGrid or Kitsu. And we can also do inherent, where you can inherit your version from the assembly file downstream. So if you look at this, for example, then the camera department publishes a camera, it comes into the shot assembly, but animation loads the camera again from the shot assembly into the animation file. So whenever the camera department updates the camera, then the layout department knows, hey, there's a new version of the camera. And automatically updates because we set the shot assembly then to auto subscription. So this has a few benefits. Like there's only one file for the CG soup to check. There's also the ability to push certain publishers further downstream. So we can say whenever you publish your animation is made with a set, but the set is a proxy. But when you publish it through the shot assembly where the actual set is loaded in, and you get a play blast with the full set and maybe with the lights also in there. Artists can also work simultaneously now. So they don't need to be, they don't, are not in their way because nobody touches the publishers of another department. Still, it's not preferred to have people working simultaneously, but at least it's a possibility in stress times. And it also gives us the possibility, which I think is very valuable, to graph which versions are loaded into a specific publish. So let's say at the end of the whole pipeline, we have an image sequence, and then we can say which versions are used to create this image sequence and what's their current status on ShotGrid. So we can make a quick overview to actually see if all of the versions that are used are the ones that are approved, and if not, fix it. And then we love Blender, as we all do here. But I do think it fits very well into our pipeline because, as you can see, we use lots of different software. Having all of those subscriptions, managing that on the workstations, Blender is just always there. Because it's a REST package for us on the server, any computer can be a Blender computer. Just like this, so we can have every computer join in our farm at night if we want. We can have somebody open up a scene that's usually not on a Blender person and just look at what's actually in there. So I think it fits our pipeline very well. And now I'll give it back to Milo, and he's going to tell something about future projects.
Yes. Thank you, Thierry. So. Don't boo when I do the next image, because this is a project that's now in production that's using Maya mainly, but we also have a little bit of Blender in there. But we are very keen on doing more 3D projects in Blender, so all the other projects we have in development now, like Seekers, is something that we are already doing a test for an American company. And I can't say which one, but it is a really cool one. But this is a project we're now doing completely in Blender, and I'm very excited about it. The art is by Denny Diaz. It was kind of like, as we picked up his art, and we thought we need to make a show about this, a sci-fi show. So hopefully, in a little while, we are actually going to be greenlit, and we can start production on that. And the other thing that we also are a bit more like a kid show, which is Paul the Pirate Mouse, we also hope to do in Blender soon. So these are things still in development, and we're not quite sure when they're going to happen. But I'm always very keen to say, please email us if you are like, oh, these projects are interesting, because we might just keep you in mind for the future. And like also, we're specifically looking now for a pipeline developer. So if you're someone here that is that, we are very keen to get an email from you, because we would love to work together. But also generally, feel free to email us if you have questions or you're specifically interested in any degree of working with us on one of these projects that I showed. But that was that was it. I hope if you have any more questions, I don't know if you have time for that.
We'll be here.
Well, we will be here in the building, so you can ask us questions if you like.